All right, hello everyone. In today's video, we're going to be concluding our discussions on power series and where they converge, where they diverge, that sort of thing. You may remember, it was a long time ago now, it was right before spring break. We started talking about the ratio test. We defined power series and all that stuff. And we talked about these two things, the interval of convergence and the radius of convergence. And we've used the ratio test to solve for this radius a whole bunch. Remember, that's basically like a range of x values where inside that, well, I guess it'd be a domain, not a range, but it's a domain of x values where the power series will definitely converge as n approaches infinity. And we said the radius doesn't help you with the endpoints. You don't know if the endpoints are maybe included or they're excluded, or it could be one of each. So the reason why we studied all these other tests was to help us make the decision on the endpoints. The ratio test always gives you the inner window. All the other tests help us decide on the endpoints. So today we're going to go back to the ratio test, and now our task is going to be not just determine convergence or divergence, it's going to be determine the interval of convergence. So really every single problem has like three pieces to it. Let's go ahead and jump right into an example. So I've got a power series here. Our goal is to find the interval of convergence. No matter what, first thing you're still going to do is hit it with the ratio test because we need to know the radius of convergence. That way we can figure out what are the endpoints I have to look at. So, ratio test, limit n goes to infinity. Don't forget the absolute value, negative x to the n plus 1 over n plus 1. Divide by or multiply by the reciprocal. Let's see, I see a couple negatives in here. So they divide out, and then the absolute value would hit them anyway, so who cares? Let's rearrange this a little bit. The n's and the n plus 1 are always going to be positive, so they can come out of the absolute value. Whoops, that's n plus 1 over x to the n, which then this could divide as well. That'd really be x to the n times x to the 1. So I think we have the limit as n approaches infinity of n over n plus 1 times the absolute value of x. Now remember, the limit only operates on the stuff with the n's. So it's basically the limit of these n's times the absolute value of x. Conveniently, this limit approaches 1. So really, we have 1 times the absolute value of x, or we just have the absolute value of x. The rule from the ratio test was, whatever you get out of the ratio test has to be less than 1 for convergence. Since the x is isolated, immediately I know the radius of convergence is 1. Now, it's been a little while, but if we were thinking about, okay, what's the interval of convergence there? That's what we got to look at. So I'm going to argue that this power series is centered at 0. You could say center, which normally we've used the a value for that, but I don't see an a in here. So you know, it's not like x minus 3 or x plus 2. It's just x to the n. So I'm going to argue the center is 0. If you want to go ahead and solve that absolute value inequality, it'll help you out if you don't like the argument around the center. So we could say like the absolute value of x, oops, well, we're going to solve it, so we probably don't want that absolute value anymore. You can either say x is less than 1 or x is reverse the sign, reverse both signs, reverse the inequality, stick a negative on there. So our temporary interval of convergence will look something like this, negative 1 less than x less than 1. But here's the deal. We don't know on these inequalities. Are they just less thans? Or maybe are they less than or equal to? Or maybe is one of them less than or equal to, and the other one's a less than? So that's going to be our decision here. How do we make that decision? We're going to try them both. So pick one, doesn't matter. I'm going to do the negative one first. We're going to say let x equal negative 1. Come back to your original power series, plug in negative 1. So we would have the sum from n equals 1 to infinity of negative, and it was x to the n. Now I'm going to make it negative 1 to the n over n plus 1. Hey, that's a series of constants. Now we can use all our other series convergence rules to try and figure this one out. Let's see, it's kind of messy with this extra negative, so I'm going to bring it out front here just so I can avoid thinking about it. And let's see, well, I see a sign flipper in here. There's a sign flipper. And well, this is just the alternating harmonic series, right? This one, this converges by the AST. It strictly alternates. I guess I should show all my work, right? It strictly alternates. It decreases in magnitude, decreases in magnitude, and it trends to zero. Okay, so because this power series converges, I know negative one is an okay value to include in the interval of convergence. So I'm going to update that inequality to be negative one less than or equal to. Now let's do the same thing with the other one here. So now let's say let x equal one. Then we would have, give me a little more space, computer, thank you. So again, replacing the original x to the n, I've got to put in my one there, and then it was over n. Well, again, same trick on that minus. I'm just going to bring it out front. This is the harmonic series. So this diverges by P series test. Again, I know I've said this like 100 times, but it's because both of them are correct answers. You could either say it diverges by the P series test, or by harmonic definition. Okay, so because this one diverges, that means positive one cannot be included in our interval of convergence. So we're just going to leave it the way it is. We're just going to leave it as a less than. So our actual interval of convergence is negative one included, one excluded. Or if you want to do the compound inequality, you say negative one less than or equal to x less than one. That is a full power series interval of convergence problem. By the way, did this thing look familiar up here? This original problem, did that look familiar? It may not have. It's been a super long time. But oh, what page was that on? Way back here. Wasn't it in the 40s or something? I think for you guys it was like 41 or 42, and then in the book it's a little different. Okay. Or I mean in the PDF. Yeah. Let's see here. Negative x to the n over. Aha, look at that. So, wasn't this the thing we just took the series of? Here's the claim I'm going to make here. Here's the claim I'm going to make that natural log of 1 minus x is approximately, since that's approximately equal to all those things, well, I'm just going to put out the general term, negative x to the n over n. And of course, there's the terms that lead up to it, right? Negative x, blah, 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 blah. Here's the idea with power series, and this is how we're going to link back up to Taylor polynomials and eventually make Taylor series. That's section 10, making Taylor series. We're going to make the claim that the natural log of 1 minus x not is approximated by, but actually is this infinite power series for as long as you're inside the domain of negative 1 to positive 1. This is huge. That means we can replace the natural logarithm function with a polynomial and match it perfectly. Oh, as long as we use infinite terms and we stick the x values between negative one and positive one. No big deal, right? That's earth-shattering. Isn't that beautiful, amazing, something like that? Goodness, I just love it. Okay, let's do one more. This one comes from the assignment, so it should help you out with a couple that I gave you to practice. This one's number 51. And same job, radius and interval of convergence. So, as always, I'm going to start with radius, and I'm going to get the ratio test to start me off. You're always going to start with the ratio test. Ratio test. Once again, notice it's just x to the n. It's not x minus some value to the n, so I know it's centered at 0, so I know my endpoint should be symmetric around 0. Anyway, doesn't matter. Well, it's helpful, but you can also get there algebraically. So let's see, x to the n plus 1 over n plus 1 squared times 3 to the n plus 1. And then divide by or multiply by the reciprocal, n squared, 3 to the n over x to the n. Okay, so hopefully you're getting used to simplifying these by now. Let's see, I'm bringing the n squareds all the way out front. Oops, that's a squared. Let's see here, the 3 to the n would divide with this. 3 to the n will be left over with a 1/3 somewhere. And then this x to the n will divide with that one. We'll be left with 1x. And there's our absolute value. You can bring the 3 out. You can leave it in. It doesn't matter. Because the next thing we're going to do is actually evaluate that limit. That limit equals 1 because it's n squared over n squared. So then we're going to be left with 1 times absolute value of x over 3. And again, if you'd pulled the 1/3 out, then you would have had like 1/3 times absolute value of x. Doesn't matter. I don't care. However you want to do it. Then to finish the ratio test, as always, you got to say, okay, this has to be less than 1 for convergence. And then I want you to isolate the absolute value entirely. Basically, I only want you to leave x stuff behind. So if you have this number, if you have this divided by 3 or you pull it out front, no matter what, because 3 is always positive, this is when I do want you to bring it out and multiply it to the other side. You can say the absolute value of x is less than 3. Because I've isolated the x term in there, I know the radius of convergence is 3. And if you don't believe me, solve the absolute value inequality. You would say either x is less than 3 or x is, whoops, equals, x is greater than negative 3. Well, both of these are 3 units away from the center 0. Center equals 0, so that r equals 3. So whichever way you want to come up with r, that is fine with me. So now we've got to check those endpoints. Let's say, well, I wanted to change the color there. It didn't work out. Let's do, it doesn't matter. You can do the positive one or the negative one first. Let's say if x is negative 3, what's going to happen? Because I need to know, is that included or is that excluded? Because the ratio test isn't going to tell us. So let's see, recopying our original sum here. Again, now I'm going to replace the x with the negative 3 to the n, and then the denominator was n squared times 3 to the n. So let's just see how we can operate on this. Well, I got some threes going on here, so why don't I pull the negative out? Now I'll have to give it the exponent of n, so it's going to be pulled out as a negative 1. But now at least we have something we can divide. I wish I could change colors without having to scroll every time. And what are we going to be left with? We're going to be left with negative 1 to the n over n squared. And let's see. Well, that's going to pass the alternating series test, right? So you could conclude from this one a couple ways. You could say, well, if it was positive, it would be a convergent P series, so it converges absolutely. Therefore, the series converges. You don't even have to check the AST, or you could check the conditions for the AST. Converges. Alternating series test. Or because absolutely convergent P series P equals 2. So either way, you're going to say, okay, yep, negative 3. Cool, that works. Now let's try let x equal positive 3. And I want to work in a different color so it's separated. So then, once again, I'm going to recopy the original sum. There it is. And this time it'd be 3 to the And well, this can simplify right away. Zoop, zoop. And this is a convergent p-series, like we just talked about for the other one. Converges by p-series. Test p equals 2. So x equals 3 is also good. The radius of convergence is 3. The interval of convergence is, and you can either do it again in interval notation, or you can make it a compound inequality. They are the exact same thing. But this means the power series will converge as long as you pick x values between negative 3 and positive 3, including those. If you need even more practice, you can look at example 7 or practice 5 in the textbook there. Okay, at this point, you are ready to go back and finish these last four that I said not yet on the other day. So let's take a look at those. As always, please let me know if you have any questions. And then in section 10, honestly, we don't have a lot of work left. In section 10, all we have to do is figure out, okay, well, basically, we're going to remind ourselves, one, how do we make Taylor polynomials? Then we're going to think about, okay, how do we generalize them? Because we need that general term. That way we can write it as a series. Then we check to see if the series converges. And then that's everything. Other than that, section 10 has some interesting reading. It'll be like, hey, this is why some of this math is useful. Whether or not you find it interesting, we'll see. So, thanks for watching. Hopefully this was helpful.